And welcome, welcome, welcome. It's time for the Legal Lounge here on CRN Digital Talk Radio, streaming live coast to coast around the world on crntalk.com. Also available in stunning high-definition video, facebook.com/CRNTalk. Also available on CRN's custom-built Roku channel and Tiki Live, and of course on crntalk.com. I am joined, as always, by the one and the only active attorney, U.S. Army veteran, Juris Doctorate in Law, undergraduate degree in physics, and author of a book that has proven to be and will continue to be a guideline for the Supreme Court now and in the future. That book, American Illusion of Freedom, is available on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and on iTunes. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Richard A. Nixon. Sir, how are you?
Very well said, Mike, and thank you very much for the kudos. I'm feeling pretty good today. In fact, because I'm one of the reasons, of course, is I am a Trump supporter. I believed in him. I think he did a lot of good for this country. And I also believe that the 2020 election, in his words, it was fixed. And it looks like more and more information is coming out regarding that. But I see that the media, the drive-by media, has already tried to pick on him for having had Kanye, or also known as Ye, and a Nick Fuentes, who apparently has made some anti-Semitic comments. He invited them to dinner, as I understand. And people are saying anyone who would do that, I think Mitch McConnell's in that group, should never be president. Well, I find that ignorant. I think that there's nothing wrong with inviting people who clearly have opposite views that you have, at least that you've heard through third parties, for the reason to see exactly what makes them tick, and to see if maybe by some chance, when you talk about your similarities, you might find out that this person has been misquoted, etc. Mr. Trump, President Trump, is known for having made friends with the head of China, North Korea, Putin, etc. And we attorneys learn that fast, that even though you're on the opposite side with another attorney, it makes sense to be friendly with that other attorney, because you may end up needing a favor that helps your client. And if you already ticked the other attorney off, it's very likely that he won't grant you that. And again, we're being friendly with the other attorney, not necessarily for ourselves, but to benefit our clients.
Yeah, former President Trump often says how the media is being unfair to him. And I think in this particular case, he's 100% correct. He took a meeting with Kanye West, who might be in a mental health crisis, but even still is a famous person with a large constituency. And he did not know, Mr. Trump, former President Trump, according to all involved, he did not know that Mr. Fuentes, who has a history of anti-Semitic and racist remarks, would be attending that dinner. And Richard, look, there's been plenty of times when someone showed up to my house for a party and they brought somebody that I did not know, who turns out to be a little bit crazy. So I think the media might be a little bit unfair to Mr. Trump when it comes to this particular instance. So stick around, you guys. We'll be right back. We're going to talk about the explosive story regarding Twitter and Elon Musk releasing some information, some backroom emails regarding some of the stuff that's regarding Hunter Biden's laptop. So stick around, you guys. We're here in the Legal Lounge, CRN Digital Talk Radio, crntalk.com. Stay with us.
No more mold, no more damage, no more outdated old bathroom, no more slipping and hurting, no more stress. Make your ordinary bathroom extraordinary for only $99 per month. New shower, new door, new tub, new wall, new anti-slip technology. Be stress-free. Call 800-973-5411. BCI Bath and Shower is made in America for the highest quality. Ask about our military and senior discounts. Your dream bathroom in as little as one day. First 50 callers save $1,500 on a never-clear glass-treated door. Call now for free premium color upgrades. 800-973-5411. Call BCI Bath and Shower, the leader in bathroom remodeling. Be smart, safe, and stay a step ahead of inflation with our interest-free financing options. Call 800-973-5411. Love your bathroom with free upgrades. Call 800-973-5411. 800-973-5411.
are back in the Legal Lounge, CRN Digital Talk Radio, crntalk.com. Just a quick reminder, during the break, you saw a cover of Richard's fantastic book, America and the Illusion of Freedom. It's available at Amazon.com, Barnes & Noble, and on iTunes. Makes a great Christmas gift out there. So make sure to check that out, you guys. Okay, Richard, so last night, all social media and the media in general were all a flux, all a Twitter, no pun intended, about Elon Musk, new owner of the said mentioned platform Twitter. He released emails, and he did this through one of his vassals, Matt Taibbi, who's a journalist formerly of the Rolling Stone, covered a lot of billionaires and stuff regarding the Iraq War. He released a trove of emails, correspondence between Twitter executives during the election cycle of 2020. And one of the things that was revealed is that there was great debate within Twitter itself about whether or not to publish any of the materials surrounding the Hunter Biden laptop story. And look, folks, I've been critical about a lot of things regarding the media, right wing and left wing, about, you know, Hunter Biden and Burisma and all that kind of stuff. But the Hunter Biden laptop story is real. If you don't believe me, you can check out the BBC. They actually have confirmed the story as well. But one thing that was revealed is that there was a lot of dialogue between people in power, people at the DNC and others, who were pressuring Twitter executives to remove content.
Correct.
And so this is we got to be careful here. Not all the facts are out about this particular story yet. I have one view. I think Richard has a separate view. But this is, I believe, evidence, and that Mr. Trump has said this all along, that the tech companies were pretty much in the pocket of big DNC Democratic and liberal groups and were moderating content on their platforms to go to sleep on the Hunter Biden laptop.
Correct. And the best part of it, or at least from the standpoint of Mr. Trump, who I think is he's somewhat justified in his claim that the 2020 election was rigged against him, was that someone has bothered to take a poll and determined or found out that 16% of the people who voted for Biden would not have done so had they known what the Twitter people had kept secret. And so it did have an impact on the election. And Mr. Trump, of course, is looking for a remedy. I propose one. I'm not sure how far it would go. But if we look at the Constitution as a contract, which I do, it's a contract between the people and the government. If the contract is breached based on fraud, then to a certain extent, whatever is done in breach of the contract, in breach of the provision of the Constitution, that should be undone. That can be undone. That's one of the remedies in court, is to set aside the agreement. Therefore, it's not too much of a stretch to say we may end up having the 2020 election done over if, in fact, it turns out that it's absolutely sure, without a doubt, that the seriousness is without a doubt, and that the only way to cure things is to have a re-election.
Mr. Trump took to his Truth Social to echo your sentiments there, Richard, and he says, and I'll read this verbatim, quote, "So with the revelation of massive and widespread fraud and deception and working closely with big tech companies, the DNC and the Democratic Party, do you throw the presidential election results of 2020 out and declare the rightful winner? Or do you have a new election? A massive fraud of this type of magnitude allows for the termination of all rules, regulations, and articles, and even those found in the Constitution. Our great founders did not want and would not condone false and fraudulent elections."
Yes, but we wouldn't need technically a new election. If the issue were brought to the Supreme Court now with absolutely unassailable proof of the fraud that occurred, with the numbers and with the current situation within the Supreme Court, it's not unlikely that the Supreme Court could simply call the 2020 election fraudulent and declare a new winner, namely the victorious party in 2016, to be the same one as 2020.
Let's get back to this. First of all, this Hunter Biden laptop story. So this first broke. The facts of the case are is that Hunter Biden, who was quite troubled at this particular time, deep in the throes of drug addiction, took his and that's public record, which he's admitted to. He took his two laptops, I believe, to a repair shop, a computer repair shop, and
yes,
on those laptops were found a treasure trove of pornographic material, self-made porno.
Yeah.
And also a lot of emails between him and his company, an energy company called Burisma, where if you read between the lines, and the reporting has been that there might have been some pay-to-play aspects regarding those emails. So the New York Post was given these the laptop, a copy of the cloned hard drive from the laptop, by the computer repair shop owner gave it to Rudy Giuliani.
Correct.
Rudy Giuliani then gave it to the New York Post.
Correct.
The New York Post wrote an article about it, and which Twitter then censored. Twitter would not allow that tweet linking to the New York Post article on their platform. The reason why, they said, and Facebook as well, is that they had information directly from the intelligence community of the United States saying that Russia was going to plan to plant disinformation into the election cycle.
Yes.
And so Twitter and Facebook said, well, hey, this Hunter Biden laptop story is pretty wacky. This has obviously got to be Russian disinformation.
Right.
So it turns out that the laptop story was real.
Correct.
And the emails that Elon Musk uncovered, which Matt Taibbi published, was pretty much a debate within internal debate between employees at Twitter on whether or not this was Russian disinformation or not. And our friend of ours, friend of the show, Swanson Food Air, Tucker Carlson, said that this was a violation of the First Amendment and he wants investigations. Is this a First Amendment issue?
Well, I'm not sure, but as you say, that it was considered to be Russian disinformation. If we go back to 2016 to 2020, during Trump's first term in office, there was nothing but allegations, false allegations of Russian disinformation that turned out to be true. So for Twitter to fall for it again and use the idea that, well, we weren't sure whether it was false Russian information or disinformation or whether it was really true, I think it falls on deaf ears as far as I'm concerned. We've now, I think, thanks to Elon Musk, we've uncovered the truth, and I think it very well should have been made public, or at least comments about it. That's the point, that Twitter and others were told not to even talk about it, or at least counseled not to talk about it. And again, many people say it cost President Trump the election.
Many people do say that, and you cited the poll number as saying that 16% of Democrats and independents that voted for Joe Biden, they would be swayed knowing that this there was truth to this Hunter Biden laptop story. We're right up against a breaker here, and so what I want to do right now is kind of play devil's advocate a little bit here.
Yes.
So Twitter, what they have said is that there's two reasons why they did not publish that New York Times tweet, why they took down the New York Post tweet, that is.
Yes.
First of all, that the material contained within that article on that tweet was from stolen information, so they had liability there.
Okay.
Secondly, a lot of the information published from Hunter Biden's laptop included a lot of that pornography, self-made pornography of himself, and you can't post somebody's nudes without their consent.
Yeah.
But I think we do have proof here that Twitter itself is involved in content moderation regarding certain candidates and certain political parties, whether or not the Biden administration, because he wasn't in office that particular time.
True.
But the so-called deep state, with the allegiances to the DNC and otherwise, that's something we want to talk about after the break. So stick around, you guys. We'll be right back.
Very good.
Are you paying too much for term life insurance? There's a tremendous price war among the major term life companies. Rates have dropped dramatically in the past few years. For example, a man age 45 non-tobacco user, $1 million of coverage is only $75 per month, level for the next 10 years. Or a man age 50 non-tobacco user can buy $500,000 of coverage for a monthly premium of only $110. Guaranteed not to change for the next 20 years. That's right, level rates for 20 years. And if you're a smoker, we have great rates for you as well. At the Term Lifeline, we specialize in policies of $500,000 and above. So if you're looking for new or replacement term life insurance, call right now for a free quote.
Rates and availability may vary by state. Sample rate quotes are based on preferred non-tobacco underwriting exam required to qualify.
800-349-6855. 800-349-6855. 800-349-6855. That's 800-349-6855.
Have you heard about vine-to-bar chocolate? It's the winemaker's chocolate, the world's first chocolate made with Wellvine Chardonnay Mark. from the beautiful coastal vineyards of North America. Gently pressed grapes are harvested after juicing, dried and finely milled, and carefully blended into the finest dark chocolate. The Chardonnay Mark contains highly beneficial grape nutrients, flavanols, and has a natural sweetness that flavors the luscious dark chocolate. Mouthwatering, flavorful, delectable dark chocolate goodness with Chardonnay sweetness and beneficial nutrients. And it's alcohol-free, too. It's Vine to Bar Chocolate. Order some today at vinetobar.com. That's VINETOBAR.com. Cold shipped to your door, it's Vine to Bar. Vine to Bar Chocolate. Visit us at vinetobar.com.
Hi, this is Fred Dwyer talking about my favorite Italian restaurant, Angelo's and Vinci's at 550 North Harbor Boulevard in downtown Fullerton. A fantastic place to eat. Come inside and dine in our Italian town square, complete with a 10-foot Christmas tree. That's right, 10 feet. Enjoy our food made from secret family recipes. Pasta, chicken, seafood, salads, and our delicious pizza. Incredible desserts, including my favorite, the tiramisu, flown directly in from Italy. Feel the spirit at Angelo and Vinci's, 550 North Harbor Boulevard in Fullerton, California. Call 714-879-4022 or visit angelosandvincis.com. That's angelosandvincis.com.
Back in the Legal Lounge. Thank you so much for joining us here. Just wrapping up this story about Hunter Biden's laptop and reporting out of Twitter headquarters. That's the previous Twitter regime before Elon Musk purchased Twitter. Sought had great debates on whether or not to publish the New York Times post New York Post story about Hunter Biden and his laptop. So, Richard, we both watched Tucker last night, and Mr. Tucker said that this was a First Amendment situation, and I didn't see anything in the story regarding direct pressure from the administration to censor anything. And in fact, Matt Taibbi, the journalist who compiled these emails, said in a series of tweets that there were, quote, no evidence that I've seen of any government involvement in the laptop story. But that, I think, is a little bit misleading as well, because it was in 2020 where the FBI said that pretty much any negative reporting about Hunter Biden and his laptop was Russian disinformation.
Well, okay, there is such a thing as prior restraint, where the government gets involved in preventing people from speaking about certain topics. So this could very well be what Mr. Carson was thinking about, is that Twitter, acting as like a semi, if you will, semi-government, if you will, because mm-hmm. of its power, was basically instructed not to present certain items on their Twitter posts and so on, that you are getting involved in First Amendment, as you said, content. And therefore, I think it would border on the First Amendment. However, we have to remember the First Amendment has been used for everything. And the First Amendment basically says that Congress shall make no law regarding freedom of speech and press and so on. And it's gone so far afield that almost anything anyone says, at least if they're semi-political, especially political, could be put under the rubric of First Amendment. And as you said, the contents of whatever someone said or was counseled not to say.
Yeah, the First Amendment gets thrown around a lot.
Absolutely.
And a wise man once told me that oftentimes what you think the law should be is not what the law is. And the First Amendment, Twitter has all the rights under the First Amendment themselves.
Correct.
For freedom of association to do whatever they want on their platform.
Correct.
If they don't like what I post, they can take it down.
Well, not only that, but if they're in the business of doing what I guess they're in the business of doing, and that is allowing people to speak freely through their apparatus, then I think I have a hard time for them sitting back and deciding, well, let's see, today, what are we going to allow people to talk about? That is a bit of arrogance, and I think that is a violation of the First Amendment, where they're scrutinizing what people can say. They may not like what was said or what was done, but as far as they're concerned, the idea that this was another false thing regarding the Russians only supports my theory that they knew it wasn't false information from the Russians. They simply wanted, especially coming from the DNC, they were simply helping the DNC elect Mr. Biden.
My personal opinion is I don't necessarily think I would go that far. I would say, though, that Twitter and I think the tech companies in general, because their employees and customers are very usually liberal.
Yes.
They are very hyper-focused and hyper-attentive to how they're perceived amongst the mainstream liberal media.
Correct.
And so even if they did post this New York Post article about Hunter Biden, which has proven to be true.
Yes.
They would be then perceived as being in the tank for President Trump. And then they would get that huge liberal backlash, that, quote, cancel culture.
Right. And we have to remember that the Constitution, first of all, was never intended to solve all of our problems. The Constitution was intended to create a federal government with very limited powers. All the other powers, according to the 10th Amendment, still reside in the states and the people. However, on the flip side of that, the Constitution was never intended to frustrate the people from solving their problems. So here we've got a situation where I think everyone is gradually growing toward Trump's view that the 2020 election was fixed somehow. We've got all these examples of fraud and miscounting of votes and so on, and nothing can be done? I think not. I think what could happen is that those same, the Alito case that he presented to the Supreme Court, arguing that we should review what happened in Pennsylvania.
Pennsylvania case, yeah.
Those cases, I think, could show that, in fact, Mr. Trump, if it were done correctly, had the proper votes and presented to the Supreme Court now might result in a reversal.
Interesting. So we'll look at this story moving forward, and I'm sure there's going to be some fallout at Twitter and beyond. Stick around, guys. We'll be right back right after the break and talk about the felony murder rules. Stay with us.
Experiencing pain, back pain, shoulder, elbow, or hand pain, pain from a sports injury? If so, schedule a visit with Dr. Michael Sheps, the leading expert in laser therapy for pain management. Call 310-873-4422 or go to drsheps.com. Experience Epic T, the breakthrough laser therapy system that Dr. Sheps developed to make you pain-free in less time. Laser therapy is a non-invasive, safe, and effective in-office procedure that penetrates deep into your skin without damaging the tissue. It perfectly targets areas of pain to promote fast, natural healing. Relax your muscles, ease muscle spasms, joint stiffness, and arthritis pain while increasing blood circulation. For over 25 years, Dr. Sheps has helped Olympic athletes and sports enthusiasts alike get back in the game. Schedule your visit with Dr. Sheps at his Brentwood office in California. Call 310-873-4422 or visit drsheps.com. That's drsheps.com. 310-873-4422.
Let's talk about your credit cards. When you first start using them, it's a slow drip. You make charges, then more charges, then bills come, and they keep coming. When you open your statements, the floodgates come pouring in. You realize you have more credit card debt than you can afford, and you're barely making the minimum payments. Wouldn't it be nice to make one affordable payment and have all your credit card bills covered? Make this free call and learn our responsible way to get your credit card bills paid and under control.
Sponsored by Consumer Education Services, a nonprofit organization.
800-876-3643. 800-876-3643. 800-876-3643. That's 800-876-3643.
CESI is not a loan company. The establishment of a debt management plan may adversely affect your credit rating. Non-payment of debt may lead creditors to increase finance and other charges to undertake collection activity, including liquidation.
When you really want Italian food, you have got to get to Columbo's. Columbo's Italian Steakhouse and Jazz Club. Colorado Boulevard, Eagle Rock. It's that little neighborhood place you wish was down the street from you. Today, it seems so hard to enjoy just a little bit of easy. So much of life seems to get in the way. But fear not, seekers of fabulous food and fun and thrill. Columbo's is Southern California's answer to Easy Street. Great grub with some of the finest steaks, the freshest fish awaiting for you to devour. Did I mention Columbo's family Italian recipes? Columbo's spaghetti bolognese, their chicken pesto ravioli, magnifico, and of course, the world's greatest meatballs. I can go on. But why go on when you can go on over to Columbo's and experience delicious and easy for yourself? Columbo's, of course, that little neighborhood place you wish was down the street from you. Columbo's, mangia bene.
Now you can get generic Viagra shipped to your door for about $2 a pill. Get the same impact for less. Call Steel Man Pills now and get the same blue pill for about $2 a pill. Call now for the 50-pill special and save even more. Plus, get a free bonus.
800-605-1683. 800-605-1683. 800-605-1683. That's 800-605-1683.
Hi, everybody. Michael Horn along with Fred Dreyer here in the Sports Lounge. We look behind the scenes and the world of sports, do we not, Fred Dreyer?
We look behind and in front sometimes.
Really?
Yes.
Check them both out and you can see everything there. This isn't your show for sports scores. This is the show about the politics of sports.
We're not ripping and reading. We don't care about what the Phillies and the St. Louis Cardinals did in the third inning on a rainy day. Who cares? We're here to give you insight into a certain part of the sports world you don't normally see.
Wednesdays at 4 on CRN.
And we are back in the Legal Lounge, CRN Digital Talk Radio, CRNTalk.com. Thank you so much for joining us once again. So, Richard, you gave me a treat today because, you know, I love talking about criminal law. You know, it's just I find it fascinating. I'm a big true crime fan. It's a little dark and morbid, but I don't know. There's something about it that always interests me. And so this next case, we've talked about the felony murder rule here and specifically in California on a past sessions, that the felony murder rule, well, basically, Richard, just break down what the felony murder rule was before it was changed here in California.
Yes. Prior to the felony murder rule, if an individual, we'll call him the defendant, was involved in a conspiracy to commit a felony, generally maybe to rob a bank or to go into a 7-Eleven and beat some people up and take their money, whatever. He's part of a conspiracy, if you will. If he's, if you will, using my terms, if he's the most innocent of the group, maybe he's the getaway driver or whatever. He does nothing other than driving the car. He has no gun. He has no intention of shooting anyone. However, if there is a homicide, that is an unlawful taking of life, during the administration of that robbery, if you will, he is treated as though he pulled the trigger of the gun.
And that we've seen some just kind of just terrible stories, you know, stories out there of, you know, some poor 18-year-old kid who really didn't even know that a robbery was going to occur. He's driving the getaway vehicle. His buddy jumps out, goes in, shoots the liquor store clerk, and they get caught. And now my guy who's driving the car is doing a life sentence. Now in California, we had Senate Bill 1437.
Correct.
To amend the felony murder rule and the natural and probable consequences doctrine as it relates to murder to ensure that murder liability is not imposed on a person who is not the actual killer.
Correct.
And now we have this Vargas case. Please continue about this case.
So what the Vargas case is we've got, if you will, two sets of two people, both in two different gangs, and one of the gangs had a female in there and in it, and the girl's name is Cynthia Vargas. She went to the park one day with her two friends, and they met two other guys who were apparently from another gang. They talked about what gang they were in, if they were in a gang, and eventually two of the guys got into a fist fight. The one, I won't call him a gentleman, the one guy from the other gang, if you will, was apparently bigger than the smaller one, if you will, our gang, Miss Vargas's gang. And so Miss Vargas yelled out, "Shoot him." And one of the people that was with Miss Vargas pulled his gun out, went to shoot the bigger of the two, and the brother of the bigger of the two got in the way. He ended up shooting the brother in the back. As they were leaving at this point, now that wasn't a fatal shot. Shooting him in the back did not kill him. But on the way out, if you will, or leaving that scene, the person who shot the brother saw the other brother, if you will, the one of the people that was on the other side, shot him in the head a couple times and killed him. And so the issue became, first of all, the idea of a felony murder rule came to be argued because Miss Vargas was held was found guilty of first degree murder. And of course, the felony murder rule as amended came to be argued because, as we had said earlier, as Mike said earlier, the person that she didn't actually do the killing, therefore she should, under the new felony murder rule, she should not have been held liable for first degree murder. However, what this court did, and it was confirmed on appeal, is they treated her as an aider and abettor and somehow got around the so-called felony murder rule and did get her. She was convicted of first-degree murder. She brought a motion for habeas corpus, and the conviction was reduced to second degree, and the Court of Appeals affirmed her second-degree murder sentence.
See, this is interesting to me. So, yeah, like you said, following the jury trial, Vargas, the woman, and Alcantar, the actual shooter, were convicted of first-degree murder with also different subsections, involves different enhancements, murder with a firearm, also right. Murder with the benefit of criminal street gang, whatnot. Right. And what's interesting to me, Richard, is that, so this the Court of Appeals threw out the conviction and then gave her a second-degree murder conviction. Wouldn't that require a new trial? How can an appeals court come to you and say, well, the jury convicted you of first-degree murder, we're actually going to just convict you of second-degree murder?
No, the Court of Appeals can review the facts and hold that for one reason or another, what the defendant was convicted of is not sufficient to hold her for first-degree murder, because again, we'd have to get into what the first-degree murder statutes say and the punishment therefore. In other words, she did not hide behind a bush. She did not get paid by contract to kill somebody. So in other words, she did not actually do the killing, if you will. So that seems to eliminate first-degree. But second-degree murder is also acting with the reckless disregard of injury to another person. And that is what this court found, that she acted in such a malicious way, knowing full well that this person she ordered to shoot so-and-so would do it, and he did do it, and therefore they found that it was, in spite of the new felony murder rule, she was guilty of second-degree murder. Now, it may still go up to the Supreme Court, and it may be reversed. They might have to find her guilty of manslaughter only.
Ms. Vargas, after her first conviction, pre-appeal, when she was convicted of first-degree murder with two enhancements, one the use of a firearm and the second the
correct
advancement of a gang activity, she was sentenced to 60 years to life.
Yes.
Now, after the Court of Appeals came in and reduced that to second-degree murder, now, according to my research staff, she's looking at about 30 years to life.
Right.
It's not much of a change. Really.
No, there isn't. And again, we don't have enough time to go into all those details, but even first-degree murder has three different gradations as to how you will be sentenced. Sometimes it's 25 years to life. The other time it might be 25 years to life without possibility of parole. If you killed a certain kind of victim,
yeah,
if you will, a police officer,
yeah,
et cetera, then it might be the death penalty and so on. So the again, there's so many gradations that it would take up the whole show.
Well, I want to ask you right after the break here. With so many different gradations, in front of the show, Dennis Prager actually made this point.
Yes.
You know, all these different factors, and with new technology, can we decide all this stuff via computer, via artificial intelligence? I'm going to pose that question to you right after the break. Stick around. We'll be right back.
Yeah.
Do you have Medicare and do you use a CPAP machine? This is a national healthcare alert regarding your CPAP supplies. Using a clean CPAP mask and clean supplies is important to staying healthy. The best way to make sure your CPAP equipment is clean is to get new supplies. If you have Medicare, we have great news. Medicare will pay for you to have new clean supplies every 90 days. We'll even do all the paperwork for you to make sure that there's little to no out-of-pocket cost to you. And you don't even have to leave your home. We provide free in-home delivery. So if you're a CPAP user and you have Medicare, staying healthy with new CPAP equipment is easy. Just make this free phone call right now to get started.
Sponsored by Specialty Medical. 800-846-2153. 800-846-2153. 800-846-2153. That's 800-846-2153.
Have you heard about vine-to-bar chocolate? It's the winemaker's chocolate, the world's first chocolate made with well-vined Chardonnay marc from the beautiful coastal vineyards of North America. Gently pressed grapes are harvested after juicing, dried and finely milled, and carefully blended into the finest dark chocolate. The Chardonnay marc contains highly beneficial grape nutrients, flavanols, and has a natural sweetness that flavors the luscious dark chocolate. Mouthwatering, flavorful, delectable dark chocolate goodness with Chardonnay sweetness and beneficial nutrients. And it's alcohol-free, too. It's Vine to Bar Chocolate. Order some today at vinetobar.com. That's VINETOBAR.com. Cold shipped to your door, it's Vine to Bar. Vine to Bar Chocolate. Visit us at vinetobar.com.
And we are back in the Legal Lounge. Once again, thank you so much for joining us. Richard's fantastic book, American Illusion of Freedom, available on iTunes, Barnes & Noble, and on Amazon.com. Check it out. Order it for Christmas. Richard, this Vargas case, it keeps getting more and more interesting now that I'm reading the full opinion here. So she was convicted of first-degree murder by the jury. She got the 60 years to life. She filed a writ of habeas, and based on the new California felony murder rule, because she actually did not pull the trigger.
Correct.
The Court of Appeals came in and says, hey, all right, well, now we'll actually just sentence you under second-degree murder, I guess, which she agreed to. Now, according to my research staff, she was sentenced to 10 years for second-degree murder, but then another 20 years for an enhancement for a felony involving a firearm. How could she be charged with a firearm enhancement if she wasn't the one that actually had the gun in her hand?
Well, that's right. And see, that's where the felony rule, having been amended, might help her. That 10 years might stick. But the 20 years for using a gun in the commission of a felony, that might get wiped out because of the amendment to the felony murder rule. She, technically, poor thing, she didn't shoot anyone. So you've got a different class of innocence there. One was the guy just driving the getaway car was relatively innocent. In this case, she's relatively innocent in that she didn't pull the trigger either. So I would say this case is not over. She might spend the next 20 years fighting for voluntary manslaughter or something less.
Before we reap too much sympathy on Mrs. Vargas here, yeah. She did say, shoot the... A few seconds later, she said, hurry up, shoot this. And so, yeah, she is, in my opinion, she probably is where she needs to be. But I'd be very interested to see this firearm enhancement, too. And you said, too, that liberals, especially here in California, for so long have passed all these enhancements, firearms enhancements to deter criminals from using firearms
Correct.
In violence. And here's a 25-year enhancement on the books. And believe me, folks, criminals know the law just as much as attorneys do.
Yes, they do.
And so she knew that, you know, these parties knew that you use a gun, you're getting a 25 years extra, and they still did it. So that deterrence is not really working, right?
Well, in this case, it is, because what I'm saying is I was of the impression that our new district attorney or attorney general were both trying to undo these enhancements, but it looks like that particular enhancement, using a gun in the performance of a felony, stuck, and she got an additional 20 or 25 years. But again, like we said, now what's interesting about this, though, is you can bet that the public defender is the person who's arguing for her. She probably doesn't have the money, and I'm just guessing. But in order for an attorney to do this case, it would cost a fortune. And I'm thinking that this is what public defenders do. They take an oath to see that justice is done. And oftentimes, the prosecutor and the public defender, they do the best work in opposing each other. And it's not through. This case is not done.
And, you know, one thing that really, you know, burns my biscuits is when I see on social media, you know, people, anything regarding a criminal trial, we're like, oh, how can this defense attorney represent
Correct.
This person?
Correct.
And it's, and why? I believe personally that public defenders deserve our respect and admiration.
Absolutely.
Because they're taking cases that nobody else wants for very little money sometimes.
Correct.
And so what do you say to those people who are like, oh, how could you represent that monster?
Well, again, if he's a private attorney, what he's doing is, when a person says that to me at a social gathering, for instance, how can you, Richard, how can you defend these people? You know they're guilty. My first question is, guilty of what? Because we've talked about it before, Mike, that there's first-degree murder, second-degree murder, voluntary manslaughter, involuntary manslaughter, and then maybe just criminal negligence or no liability at all on the part of the defendant. And it's up to the attorney, the defense attorney, to force the state to prove under what circumstances this victim's life was taken, because depending upon how that life was taken directly impacts the sentence that this defendant will receive. So there's a big difference in what she got, if you will, starting off at 60 years. It was reduced down to 30 years, and if she can get that reduced down to voluntary manslaughter and maybe a couple years.
And but the case, the crime took place in 2002.
Right.
And so she's got many years served at this point. So this could be ruled that enhancement is stricken down.
Right.
She probably is walking out the next day. But like you said, you know, cases, criminal cases, all cases, civil, criminal, anything, they're like snowflakes. Each one is different.
Correct.
And so that whole argument of Dennis Prager about using AI and so forth for a computer to make these decisions, that doesn't
yes.
really hold water, right?
And frankly, I would turn the mirror back for Dennis to look in the mirror and see how much of what he says could be simply done via a computer. There would be no need for the Dennis Prager show.
Well, I hope not, because it's on CRN3 in weekdays. So this is an interesting case. I have the full decision here. I'm going to actually post it on our Facebook, because I think it's something interesting to look at. But the felony murder rule, 1437, new here in California. We've talked about that extensively. But like you said, Richard, and also I wonder, post-Bruin, the Bruin case.
Yes.
I wonder, if these firearm enhancements, if there's going to be some wise constitutional attorney out there post-Bruin, which pretty much says that citizens do have the right to protect themselves with the Second Amendment outside
Correct.
The home
Correct.
Without a permit, I wonder if that'll come into play, too. Stick around, you guys. We'll be right back right after the break and wrap things up. Stay with us.
We'll be right back.
Hello, everybody. Mike Gary here at CRN, reminding you to join us in the lounge Monday through Friday at 4 p.m. Pacific Time, 7 p.m. Eastern Time, right here on CRN Digital Talk Radio. Mondays, join Mike Horn for a fantastic lounge show. Tuesdays, it's the Legal Lounge with Richard Nixon, and yes, he is live. The Sultan of Safeties, Fred Dreyer, in the Sports Lounge on Wednesdays. Thursdays, it's the Business Lounge with financial expert John Truman Wolf. And on Fridays, head into the weekend with Mike Horn. The Lounge, Monday through Friday, 4 p.m. Pacific Time on CRN Talk.
Hi, this is Fred Dreyer talking about my favorite Italian restaurant, Angelo's and Vinci's at 550 North Harbor Boulevard in downtown Fullerton. A fantastic place to eat. Come inside and dine in our Italian town square, complete with a 10-foot Christmas tree. That's right, 10 feet. Enjoy our food made from secret family recipes. Pasta, chicken, seafood, salads, and our delicious pizza. Incredible desserts, including my favorite, the tiramisu, flown directly in from Italy. Feel the spirit at Angelo and Vinci's, 550 North Harbor Boulevard in Fullerton, California. Call 714-879-4022 or visit angelosandvincis.com. That's angelosandvincis.com.
Do you want to fly somewhere, anywhere in the world? Smart travelers call myflightsearch.com for the best deals on flight tickets. Going to Manila, Bangkok, London, how about Singapore? Call myflightsearch.com for the lowest flight tickets available. What about a local vacation? Let's say you want to fly to Vegas, Orlando, Miami, Los Angeles, or Denver. Pick up the phone and call myflightsearch.com right now. We have exclusive deals that you can't find anywhere else. The only way you can get these low airline prices is by calling us. We have so many low prices available, we can't possibly tell them to you right here and now. If you're flying somewhere anytime in the next 6 months and you want the lowest airline ticket prices anywhere, you owe it to yourself to save a ton of money. So pick up your cell phone and call myflightsearch.com right now.
Call 800-445-3166. 800-445-3166. That's 800-445-3166. Call now. 800-445-3166.
Then you will know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. John 8:32. Hi, this is Jeremy Dayton. Join me Sunday nights at 9 p.m. Pacific on Truth Radio, where we'll unpack the cultural baggage and discern what truth is amongst the sea of disinformation, the truth from God's perspective. With powerful guest testimonies, we'll also expose lies of the world created to spread fear and confusion. Matthew 6:34 says, "Therefore do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself." Let's do that by seeking God's truth together. Sunday nights at 9 p.m. Pacific on CRN 6.
And we are back in the Legal Lounge. Thank you so much for joining us. As always, all past and previous sessions available on YouTube. Search for Richard Nixon Live or CRN Digital Talk on YouTube. Also as a podcast, crntalk.com/podcaster. Richard, this next one I like. This is a lawsuit. Just a little quick background here, very briefly. Governor Newsom signed a bill up at the Politburo up in Sacramento saying that by 2035 here in California, that all new cars sold must be electric only.
Cars and passenger trucks, yeah.
And now we have a lawsuit with perhaps equal protection argument about this would hurt low income people and minorities.
Yes, September 2030 signed the executive order saying that all new cars and passenger trucks sold in California must be zero emission vehicles. But there is a lawsuit pending now. The name of the law firm is Holland and Knight. The partner, Brian C. Bunger, wrote in the complaint that the Black, Latino, and Native American residents are disproportionately likely to be low income, and it will cause racially disparate harms to communities of color. I'm sorry. He also said that the court should invalidate the rules because they violate the Due Process and Equal Protection Clause of the U.S. Constitution and the California Constitution. He also claimed, and we hear this quite often, Mike, we're going to have to explain this more next time, violations of the California Administrative Procedures Act and the Environmental Quality Act. The California Administration's Procedure Act is modeled after the federal one, and that's the one where they talk about DACA and these other different things that the executive branch ignores that. That's simply another due process thing where you're supposed to tell the people what you're going to do. Once they've had a chance to feedback to you, then you pass the law, the executive order. So in any event, there is a lawsuit afoot to try to undo the law that Newsom passed, which again is an executive order. It was not passed by Sacramento.
Yes, and this is, I like this lawsuit because electric cars are expensive. I believe that the cheapest one you can probably get is around $40,000, and you are pretty much saying, hey, if you're not rich, if you don't have $40,000 to go out there and buy a new electric car, you're out of luck.
You mentioned something else too, that if you're a renter in an apartment, what do?
Exactly, because you know you need to charge these vehicles, and so if you are living in an apartment building, a multi-family dwelling, a 16-unit apartment building, you usually don't have electrical outlets right at every stall parking lot there. So how are you going to charge it? And so what you did mention too is that this particular law, that no new car sold here in California.
Correct.
So does that mean that Governor Newsom is going to deploy the California Highway Patrol and National Guard to our borders and make sure that no gas-powered cars come in so people can buy those?
Well, that's interesting because I don't know if we mentioned it last week or the week before, but California has probably like many states a so-called use tax that if you think you're going to avoid California's tax on buying a new car here, you go to another state that maybe doesn't tax the car and bring it into California. As soon as you go to register, California is going to assess a use tax, which is equivalent to their tax that they would have assessed on you had you bought it here. So you're not going to outsmart California on that foot anyway.
People try. That's why you see a lot of people with nice luxury cars with the Minnesota plates on.
Absolutely.
There.
Absolutely.
But yeah, we're out of time, Richard, but that's how I like that lawsuit. I'm going to actually reach out to that law firm. Perhaps we can get one of their attorneys to come on and talk about it.
Yes, very good.
All right, Richard, once again, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
And we'll see you guys next week in the Legal Lounge.